two. You know what to do.
All right.
Get out of the frame. I sit my leg on the ground like an epileptic battery. Man, I'm making my moves. Let me loose like a bell.
That's official.
That's official now?
Yeah. All right. So, Dave, thank you so much for doing this.
It's my pleasure.
Really appreciate it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. When was the last manual published?
I believe it was in 2007.
2007.
Yeah.
Awesome.
That's when we did the last Alpine manual for PSIA.
Excellent. Awesome. And how and when did the process start this time around?
It started, it's hard to say exactly officially when it started, but it definitely came to light the last interski that we did, which would have been 2011. Yeah. And what we noticed is we have been preaching on how to teach student-centered approach and that sort of thing, and we were finding that a lot of people in our country and internationally were asking, that's great, that's awesome, but how, what am I teaching?
Yeah.
the information there, and we've been focused on teaching I don't want to say necessarily the softer side of the teaching skills, but we've been working on the interpersonal skills and how to keep it student-centered for so long that we kind of neglected the technical side of skiing. So we started the process really kind of then.
Okay.
We saw the need for it, where we needed some concrete answers to how to do things. Mm-hmm. But in the U.S. especially, it's... skiing has become so diverse and so broad, from fat skis to skinny skis to powder to crud to terrain parks to big air to big mountain. There's a lot of different wants out there and a lot of different tools to do it.
Yeah.
So what we have spent a lot of time on is trying to figure out what is common amongst all those.
Excellent. Yeah. And race in there.
Yeah.
In a big way.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, most of the ski areas are groomed now.
Yeah.
You know, it's special runs that they keep ungroomed or let mogul up and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. So there is still a demand for skiing on groomed snow, firmer snow, mm-hmm. smoother snow. Mm-hmm. But there's certain things that hold true there, and all the way up to big mountain skiing and waist deep crud or powder skiing or any of that terrain park. There's a lot of similarities there too.
Excellent. Yeah, flows all the way through. Those threads run
yep.
all the way through the
right.
through the fabric. Yeah.
Right. And so that's why we've really focused in the new manual on the fundamentals.
Awesome. Cooking it all down.
Yep.
Seems like yeah, it's super precise.
Try to.
Yeah. Yeah. It's really cool. So the QR codes and corresponding videos are really sweet. You're in many of them. Where and when were those filmed?
Those were filmed right at the same time as when we shot the photos for the manual.
Okay.
So a lot of those videos are actually, there was a video camera right beside the still camera, and so a lot of those videos are actually the same place that we pulled the stills from.
Okay. It's one shoot.
Yeah.
That was last spring?
End of February last year.
End of February.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
In Colorado?
In Colorado. We went to Eldora.
Eldora. How long did it take?
We spent 3 days.
3 days.
Yeah, 3 days.
3 days. Cool.
Yep.
So was being involved on that level fun, stressful, or both?
Yes.
Yes.
It was a lot of fun.
A lot of fun.
You know, I mean, anytime you get to go ski with Jennifer, Robin, Michael, and myself, and Ellen Post Foster was there.
Sure.
It's going to be fun.
You're going to have a good time.
Right. But yeah, we were very conscious and super conscious of doing what we were saying in the manual so that the pictures came as close as we could get them to exactly what we were trying to say or convey in the manual. So that was a little stressful from time to time.
Right.
But again, with having those four other people there besides myself, it was, you know, all you had to do was come down and they went, yeah, no, didn't get it. Think about this. And so you go back up and try it again.
Another lap. Yeah.
Yeah. And it was cool because we were doing it on a Palma so we could make quick laps in that sort of thing so that it was pretty stressless.
Nice.
In all honesty.
Knowing that you didn't have to nail it the first
time.
Right. Yeah, you could lap and
right.
Kind of stuff.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And everybody was really honest with each other and it was easy to say, you know, hey, I've seen you do better. Try that again.
Try that. Take another lap on
yeah.
that one.
Yeah. Yeah.
Cool. And you're a technical advisor
right.
on the manual. You and Rob and
Michael.
And Michael.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then two or three authors? Kind of.
Yeah.
What's the village?
It was.
Big village.
Yeah. It was really a village.
Yeah.
Kelly Coffey was kind of the collector of all the information and tried to put it together. Ellen Post Foster was the editor and really worked on keeping things tight in concept, tight in definitions without, so there wasn't too much writer's freedom in changing things around because it was a technical manual. We wanted to keep it pretty precise.
Sure, yeah.
And then Michael, myself, and Rob were, whenever anybody had questions, they would come and ask us. And if we all gave a similar answer without conversating beforehand, then it was good.
Right. So there must have been a tremendous amount of email
yes.
exchange going on during
yes.
this process.
Yeah, because it wasn't centralized. It was, you know, Kelly was in Colorado.
Right.
You know, Ellen was in another part of Colorado. Rob was in Salt Lake. And
there's like marinating time.
Right.
You know,
right.
drive time
yeah.
or
yeah.
mowing the lawn time or what, you know, kind of work.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. A long process.
It was a long process.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, cool. So we'll get right into the meat of it here.
Okay.
The first 35 pages introduce a significant paradigm shift in regards to how balance fits in the skills concept.
Yep.
How is this new definition of balance different from previous manuals?
Okay. What we really did is we looked back at the original concept of the skills concept. And really what we did is went back to that original definition of what the skills concept was. Yeah. The skills concept had morphed over the last 15 years, 20 years, into including balance as the fourth skill.
The big circle.
Yeah. And really how it was originally dialed up is how we're defining it now.
Okay.
So it's not necessarily that we're redefining it, we're just trying to bring it back to its original concept, which is edging, pressure, and rotary help maintain or create dynamic balance, or balance in motion, or however you want to say it. Yes, there is a little bit of element of balance that's required to start with, but that's kind of a static balance. It's a starting point. Everybody's got to have a starting point. So it helps if you're in balance to start with. But as forces and physics change and biomechanics change, it becomes dynamic. So we have edging, pressure, and rotary to control those in different ways so that we can stay in balance while we're moving.
Gotcha. It's it's a starting point. And an outcome.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And what really has changed, or what we've really gone back to, is that the skills are related to the skis. It's something physical that happens to the skis. I can edge the skis, I can pressure the skis, or I can turn the skis, and there's not much else I can do with those skis.
Interesting. Yeah. Was there much debate about this shift in the skills concept?
Not really. We just started asking the question right after the last Interski of what was the original intent or definition of the skills concept. And as we got past team members and started researching that, there really wasn't any problem with the fact that we're going back to the original.
You know, it really reads that way. You know, it reads like it has that sort of light bulb moment to it.
Right.
Those first 35 pages skills concept. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh yeah.
Well, good. I mean, that's the intent,
yeah.
And that's really what the skills concept was.
Yeah.
You know, as interpretation of interpretation of interpretation of interpretation.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of like the telephone game on the wire. You know.
Yeah.
Or the relay of telling the secret all the way down. It gets changed a little bit every time everybody interprets it. And we just wanted to go back to what it originally was.
What it originally was, yeah. Yeah, it makes a lot of sense.
I think it does.
Yeah, yeah. I remember skiing with Sean Bold last winter, and he mentioned... This is before I'd heard anything about the new you know, the manual and the skills concept getting tweaked. And maybe he had, I'm not sure. I was shadowing a clinic that he was giving, and he put it out there, like, maybe it's a result of these three things. And I scratched my head, and I took a few runs, and yeah, I really landed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
good.
Quickly.
Good.
Yeah, for me, and I'm not that smart.
Well.
So.
Yeah, and I mean, there's a few people that have had... kind of had that definition of it
for a while,
for a long time, for a while. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Well, cool. So how can we best approach this new, how can we best apply this new approach to support the beginning skier?
I think the easiest way is it's actually kind of tied in with the national standards and all of that. By focusing on the fundamentals and the skills concept, it gives us quite a bit to do. You know, most of the manual is about, it's not necessarily about how to teach, it's about giving the instructor information so that they have things to teach or that they understand so they can adapt better in their classes and that sort of thing. And what we're really trying to focus on is fundamentals and how the ski interacts in relationship to the snow. So the skills concept is I can twist my skis can change direction, my skis can tip up on edge, and my skis can get pressured, can bend. Okay?
Yeah.
And so by simplifying it back down to those things, it should help an instructor work with a lower level candidate. Because as a student is at a lower level, their skills are much more independent of each other. So you can work on one thing and another. And then as the better they get, they start to... which you know from the skills concept, they start to blend together. So it should help a beginning instructor quite a bit.
Yeah.
You know.
Simplified.
Right.
Yeah.
And if we look at the five fundamentals of you know, your center of mass maintains a relationship over your base of support along the length of the ski. You change weight from one ski to the other ski, directing it towards the outside ski of the turn. That our legs turn more than our upper body. That we tip our skis on edge by inclination and angulation, and that we control the pressure overall on the ski. You can really work with a beginning instructor or a beginning student level pretty simply, because those are the things we're trying to affect.
And those concepts are pretty easy to transfer, I would think,
absolutely.
To the beginning student.
Absolutely. You know? Absolutely. relatively easy. You know, skiing's not super easy. You know, it's a simple concept that's really hard to master. But it's easier if we just think about, we have these three tools to do that, or three skills to do that, and how my ski can interact with the snow. Right. And those are the movements we're trying to influence.
Yeah.
It makes it pretty simple.
Not a crazy amount of variables
coming
in.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Awesome. The word equilibrium popped out at me in the front part of the manual in regards to balance.
Mm-hmm.
This equilibrium. Now, that's kind of a concept I can really float my head around. If I feel like my feet are shooting out ahead of me at the end of the turn, then my equilibrium is out of whack, and I this, and you know, just maintaining that concept is something I can kind of. It's sort of sticky for me, equilibrium.
Right. It resonated with myself as well. Mm-hmm. When we started talking about balance is kind of a static thought process. I'm in balance. Mm-hmm. I get balanced. Mm-hmm. Equilibrium to me gives us some movement there, or some range of movement with it.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. It's more of a verb.
Right. Yeah. I guess.
I think.
Yeah, I don't know.
I'll have to ask my son about the verb thing, but I'm pretty sure that's the right word. So what else was I just thinking about when we were talking about that? I don't know, I slipped my mind. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
It might come back to me.
Yeah, if it does, ask it.
We can edit that part out or not. So kind of moving into a different sort of zone here when it comes to the manual. And I think it's more sort of how do we as instructors process the way that the manual was written this time around. So I'm just going to ask this question and then we kind of go from there.
Okay.
So chapters 1-5 read very technically.
Mm-hmm.
What's the best way to apply new definitions that may not align with or are slightly different from defined concepts in previous manuals?
Off the top of my head, I'm not sure which ones are different.
Mm-hmm.
But we tried very hard in writing this to be very accurate in either scientific terms or technical terms dealing with skiing. So I'm, like I said, I can't think of any that are really different than in the past manuals. Mm-hmm. But if there are some, again, it's kind of like the skills concept. It's just a different interpretation of the same information. And what we're trying to do in this manual is be very correct, either scientifically or technically correct in what we're trying to ask or say in this process.
Right.
Where you're right, it's about what the first five chapters are very much about science.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so, to the best of my knowledge, these answers are true scientifically.
Yeah. And they come across that way, and that's awesome. And I think that one of the positive byproducts of that depth is that depth, you know, and that sort of breadth of knowledge that we can draw from. It's a much deeper understanding. Counter rotation was one that was mentioned in the previous manual. You know, upper and lower body turning against each other, skis steer in and out of counter. It's a little bit more, and this puppy's got a, real depth to it.
And that's what we tried to do is I mean, that's actually a great example. What we tried to do in this is actually scientifically state how that is taking place.
Yeah.
Where before it was more of a interpretation of an interpretation and trying to figure out how to explain it simply.
Yeah, that seemed like.
And it kind of got watered down a little bit.
Yeah.
where in this one, it's like, this is what it is because this is how biomechanics, this is how your body works, or this is the law of physics, this is how it has to work.
This is it.
That sort of thing.
This is what it is. We're describing this thing. Yeah.
Right.
And
exactly.
That was the feeling that I got to reading it. I got it on last Friday.
Mm-hmm.
And it took me the weekend. I had some other stuff to do.
Well, yeah.
But it took me the weekend to...
It's not a light read.
It's not a light read. 1 through 5 is like, whew.
Yeah.
Especially that, you know, that the skills concept portion was like,
yeah.
But I got it. You know, but it's good. And I like the depth, and that's definitely...
Good. Because that's what we were trying to do. We were trying to bring some depth into, instead of just touching on concepts and ideas, we wanted to bring some depth into it.
Yeah. It's there. So, awesome. So, moving on, as technically oriented as chapters 1 through 5 are, chapters 6 and 7, movement analysis and teaching, read very lyrically
mm-hmm.
and serve as a great hands-on guide to giving awesome student-centered lessons. Could you reflect on the development of those two chapters?
We wanted to show an application of the technical stuff
mm-hmm.
that we had just written about, and how, and try to give examples on how to draw the dry technical stuff into a real lesson. The book's not about teaching per se.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about, you know, you're not going to read the first 5 chapters and go, oh, I can teach now.
Right.
But what we wanted to do is draw on some examples because that's base knowledge. The first 5 chapters are what we're trying to do is create a base knowledge for instructors.
Mm-hmm.
And then the other chapters are trying to show how to pull that information out and use it in a little bit more of a real life situation.
It's really awesome.
Well, thanks.
I mean, it reads really, really well. Like, I'll be meeting some new instructors here in a couple days, you know,
mm-hmm.
hiring some up at Mount Baker, and we give them manuals.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd almost say to the new guys, read 6 and 7 first,
mm-hmm.
and then go back, you know, and work your way
Absolutely.
Forward. But, you know, it's such a great guide.
Oh, good, good.
Yeah.
You know, that's what we worked hard on. You know, unfortunately, I can't take credit for writing. But, you know, Ellen and Kelly and Rob worked their butts off to get it written in a great way. And I think they did a very fantastic job.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's really
sweet.
Awesome. So, when and how will we see these new definitions dovetail with the new national certification standards?
Kind of the cool thing is that the new standards are written very much in the same tone as the manual is.
Mm-hmm.
When the divisions got together, the manual wasn't necessarily written yet,
mm-hmm.
But they started working together on how to change the manual, the national standards. From my interpretation of the old national standards were that they were very outcome oriented, mm-hmm. very almost to a fault of being a condition specific,
hmm.
where it was about making a nice clean turn on firmer snow, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Because we've recognized the diversity and the wants of the public skiing, mm-hmm. where it goes all over the map,
mm-hmm.
And us focusing on the fundamentals required to do any one of those, and it'll be modified depending whether you're in hard snow or soft snow or that sort of thing, the national standards are very much written that way.
Okay.
Where the 5 fundamentals in the national standards mirror the fundamentals we talk about here. And I'm not going to quote them perfectly.
Okay.
But it's basically what I said before, where it's about the base of support and center of mass maintain a relationship over the length of the ski so that the ski can do what it is, it can help in the outcome that you're trying to get. That we move from foot to foot and direct our weight to our outside ski.
Okay.
That we tip our skis on edge through angulation and inclination, or inclination and angulation. There's not one that's higher than the other one.
Okay.
And then that our skis turn more than our upper body turns, or our legs turn more than our upper body turns when we make a turn. And that we control the overall magnitude of pressure along the length of the ski.
Yeah.
And that's, in a nutshell, what the national standards are mm-hmm. for all levels of ski instruction. Right. And they're tied very tightly into the manual. And the manual kind of describes how to make that happen, mm-hmm. those things happen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it doesn't strike me as it that it would have a huge sort of shockwave
right.
through the standards, this
right.
manual. It's
kind of
right. like, you know.
They support each other really, really,
really
well.
Really well, yeah.
Yeah. And it's really, if you take the two ideas and documents and put them together, it really centers what you should be teaching and what you should be working on. I mean, the cool thing is now you can work towards a national standards,
mm-hmm.
a standard, say controlling between my center of mass and my base of support, controlling pressure along the length of the ski. I can work towards that national standard, and it also betters my skiing.
Yeah.
As opposed to working towards an outcome like they used to be.
The two things, the two documents support themselves,
yeah.
and the two actual activities, you know,
yeah.
support the working out of this or working in
exactly.
support
yeah.
them. Teaching it and
yep.
training for it.
Oh. It's pretty cool that way.
Yeah, super cool.
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, so how does the new manual's content reflect current worldviews on skiing? USSA, CSA, so forth. We can include the Austrians in there
yeah.
if you like.
we don't know yet, really, in all honesty, internationally. We can say we think it is.
that it reflects the same.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But you know, until Interski, we're not going to know for certain because we haven't gone out and pressed it against other people.
Yeah.
The foreigners that teach in the U.S. Mm-hmm. that have relationships out there all seem to like the new manual and mm-hmm. say, yeah, it's right on track.
Awesome.
It you know, good skiing's good skiing. Mm-hmm. One of the big differences is we still are process-based, not outcome-based.
Process-based, yeah.
So we still talk about the five fundamentals, or however you want to say it. It's still student-centered.
Yeah.
It's. I'm not trying to shove a short-radius arc turn on hard snow down everybody's throat. It's like, okay, what do you want to do? I can work with these fundamentals to help you get to that point.
That breadth of the experience or the activity itself, those
right.
five
right.
skills
right.
of,
and that's how we're still going to differ from other countries.
Mm-hmm. Oh, really?
Yeah, other countries still look at
on-piste
a specific outcome. There's mm-hmm. final form, if you will. Mm-hmm. You know, some other countries are getting farther, a little bit more spread out, but I don't think anybody's as spread out as we are on that.
Well, this is America, after
right.
all.
the cool thing is, you asked about USSA, is USSA has adopted a lot of our PSI's concepts very recently.
Nice.
And so it's, you know, they still say them in their own words, which mm-hmm. is perfectly desirable and nice and good. It's not a problem. But the ideas behind them mirror very much with the new manual.
Kind of
yeah, we're USSA and PSIA are coming closer together
nice.
In concept and in what to be working with people on.
So I understand there's an e-book that accompanies this
right.
manual.
Yeah, there's a digital version of the manual that you can purchase. You can either purchase solely the digital version or you can purchase the print version, but they're bundling it for $5 more. I believe is what it is, but it's a nominal amount to get the bundle of both.
Nice.
And the cool thing about that is then the ebook version is a direct link to all the QR codes and all that stuff
right.
in there, and you can download it onto your computer, onto your phone. I think it does Apple iPhone and Android.
Nice.
I know that they do those two formats for it, so nice. You can have it out in the hill with you if you wanted to.
Right. In your pocket.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly. I mean, and I'm sure there's ways that you can figure out how to have it around when you need it around.
Yeah. And the QR code's right there.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if you have a client that you wanted to
show,
describe, beep.
Yeah, you could do that. Absolutely. It's a pretty really cool concept.
Yeah.
That's coming out with the new manual.
Yeah, it's very. That's just really current.
You know? Right.
I mean, even.
It's addressing all different types of learning need, you know, desires and wants and formats and all that stuff. But it's a really cool process, and that should be coming out within a week or so.
Oh, okay, great.
Yeah,
awesome. I'll get on that. Well, great. So, last question: what are you most excited about in the new manual?
That it's here.
That it's here.
What I'm most excited about is that now we have the answers to people's questions, as opposed to going, it depends. We have a technical background, a technical format, and going around the five fundamentals, we're able to answer that question no matter what the person wants. Right.
Yeah, I'm going helicopter skiing in Alaska.
Right.
Well, let's spend some time over on the bunny hill.
Right.
Yeah.
And we can technically work with them for that outcome, and it explains how all that interacts in there.
Yeah. Yeah. Lots of threads.
Yes.
Moving through the whole concept.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, great, Dave. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Let's have a great season.
I hope so. Yeah. It'll be great. Get it out of the frame. I shake my leg on the ground, looking epileptic, battery man.